subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Hi, welcome to the Soft Cover. This is the Prince online platform for book launch. And today is the launch of a book that is titled as Mission Bengal. It's authored by Mr. Snignendu Bhattacharya. It's a HarperCollins publication. So first, we will unveil the book and welcome our author, Mr. Snignendu Bhattacharya. Hello, Snignendu. Hi. So I'm just unveiling the book. You also have a copy of the book, right?
Yes, I have.
So you just... So this is the book, yes, and the back cover. Snignendu, see, 40 years back, politics in Bengal was a completely different ball game, and at that point of time, there was this complete domination of left parties, the CPIM, and there was a very, very little opposition. I mean, there was no opposition space, and whatever opponent group at that point of time the Bengal had, it was seen as marginal. So after 90s, I would say in the beginning of 2000-2001, we saw rise of Mamata Banerjee, but she was also a marginal force then, and her presence was started being felt from 2005 post Singur movement. Yes. So since then, it was Bengal has always a leftist mind politics and leftist mind thinking all over. And despite the fact that Jansangh started from Bengal and it has been there for last, let's say, 60-70 years, but Bengal never had any connection with this brand of politics, this saffron brand of politics, right? So your book deals with this saffronization of Bengal. And when I was reading, there is this one chapter that is Lal Salam to Jai Shri Ram, right? So, start with just a little, if you can elaborate on the fact that how this deep red the Bengalis had in their mind and all over, how this red is being faded to saffron, and how this too much of leftist ideological inclination of Bengali, how they are now find sort of how they are seeing having a strange connection or inclination towards this saffron brand of politics, let's say Sangh Paribar. So how this transition?
See, if we look at the politics of Bengal over the past one century or before, then we will see that this was a land of not only secular and progressive ideas, but also Hindu revivalism. If we look at 19th century Bengal, it was the land of the Indian Renaissance or Bengal Renaissance, whatever we call it. So this kind of created the base for socially progressive and liberal thoughts across sections of the society. But at the same time, in the same 19th century, Hindu revivalism took birth in Bengal before any other place in India. This Bharat Ma concept of Bharat Mata, the Vande Mataram, this very notion that Hindus were in numerical danger from the Muslims, and all these concepts of today's Hindutva, and even the very term Hindutva, they were all product of Bengal. But during the 20th century, this secular and progressive and liberal trend of ideas, they kind of triumphed over the conservative Hindu ideas. And especially the left movement in India, it also, Bengal was one of the places where the left movement in India took its initial roots during the 1920s and 30s and 40s. So since the 1940s and 50s, this left liberal and radical ideas, they captured the mind of Bengal. it was already a land where kind of this left movement, see, you see, they also bring kind a practice of kind of atheism when they, with their politics, and this probably this culture of atheism or less religious inclination, this had its roots in the previous century. This time, when we see at the turn of the 21st century, the left influence of nearly six decades, they had started waning when Mamata Banerjee started gaining popularity. And that is because kind of the left also took a shift from their traditional support base of working for the peasants to taking steps towards industrialization. And at that point, Mamata Banerjee tried to take a kind of left bent. Mamata Banerjee's politics took a left bent. She started telling people that we are the real left. The CPM is no longer a left party. So even if we look at the change of 2011, that watershed election, Bengal largely voted for left-wing thoughts, because Mamata was at that time preaching left-wing thoughts, left-wing social programs. This time, now if there is another change, this will be the proper right turn of Bengal. Because since 2013 and now 2020, in the past 7 years, this Sangh Parivar has effectively managed to revive the old Hindu conservatism in the Bengali Hindu society. Since 2013-2014, Delhi-based think tanks and RSS functionaries here, various RSS-backed think tanks, they constantly try to remind the Bengali Hindus of the 19th and 20th century Hindu revivalism, of Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, of Vande Mataram, of Ananda Mutt, so and of other figures of the Hindu revivalism of that time. They have constantly tried to tell people, tell the Bengali people, that they need not be ashamed of Hindu conservatism or Hindutva, because they should actually be proud of it, that it is their land that gave birth to it, and then somehow they also shunned it. So
yes, please continue.
So this ideological, the battle on the ideological front that various RSS-backed organizations carried out in West Bengal over the past 7 years is going to have a long-time impact. The present rise of BJP in Bengal may to a large extent be connected to the NDA being in power in Delhi. But even if the Delhi government falls someday, the ideological benefit that the RSS has managed to harvest here, these will have give them some long-term result. BJP and RSS has been accepted as a political ideology in Bengal.
So the Sangh Parivar is here to stay now, you are saying?
Yes.
Yes. So basically, you know, when we discuss this, you know, leftist Bengalis turning rightist, and not only rightist, at some point extreme rightist, like towards RSS and Sangh Parivar, BJP is just a political outfit, but then RSS does have a very deep rooted influence on the society. And so, you know, how do you see it? Like the communist leaders, they say Mamata Banerjee has paved the way for this saffronization, or paved the way for Sangh Parivar, because earlier, as you were mentioning earlier, there was hardly any shakha used to be held in West Bengal. Now we can see thousands and perhaps a few thousands of shakhas. Like it actually increased manifold. Like what RSS used to have, let's say pre 2009 or pre-2011, now the number of shakhas has grown manifold, like 4 times, 10 times maybe. So do you really think, when you have written all these chapters, like widening fault lines, you know, widening fault lines from Laddu to fish fry, that the chapter. These are very interesting chapters that you have written. So do you really think that Mamata Banerjee and her Trinamool Congress, this party has paved the way for the Saffron Force?
You see, the left leaders are right and wrong at the same time. It is true that Mamata Banerjee's policies helped the RSS come out on the offensive and cite people how she was being biased towards one community. That is true. But at the same time, the left also didn't play their part. I mean, let me just check with my book. I have. So in 2011, when the left government fell, the RSS had 800 shakhas across Bengal. In 2014, they were 1300. So there was a leap. But at the same time, even in 2011, when RSS's number of shakhas had really come down, they were still at 800. So RSS was there. They got a chance to expand their activities due to, I would say, two or three reasons. One was in 2009. In 2009, when Mohan Bhagwat became the Sarsang Chala, the RSS took an expansion drive. It was all over India. Now, for Bengal, this expansion drive coincided with the 2009 Lok Sabha election, when the left received a massive blow. And thereafter, 2009 onwards, the left was too busy to save itself from TMC to give any attention on RSS. So 2009 onwards, RSS started going in Bengal. And the first issue that the RSS started highlighting was that of reservation of Muslims under OBC quota. Now, this was something which was initiated by the left front government during the Buddhadev Bhattacharya's last term. Mamata Banerjee took it one step further. So this was the time when the RSS backed organizations from 2012-13 onwards, they started telling OBC Hindus that, you see, the Muslims have no caste system and yet they are being included under caste reservations. So you are getting deprived. So in that case, you can't particularly blame TMC. At the same time, we have to remember that when Muslim fundamentalists staged a demonstration in Kolkata, actually they ran a riot in Kolkata's Park Circus in 2007 to drive away Taslima Nasreen from Kolkata.
Right.
A positive role did the left play. So there was those who ran a riot were fundamentalists. But did the ruling party of that time oppose that fundamentalism? No. So not opposing one fundamentalism definitely gives way for another fundamentalism to rise. So again, if we see in 2013, when Bangladesh was burning over the conviction of war criminals, those Jamaati Islami leaders who had colluded with the Pakistan army during the liberation war, several Muslim organizations in Kolkata took out a rally in Sheikh Minar in 2013, and they threatened Sheikh Hasina from that rally. Not only did they threaten Sheikh Hasina, but they also threatened every political party in Bengal of dire consequences if they supported Sheikh Hasina's move or if they supported the Shahbaz movement. So this was also a rally where the voice of Muslim fundamentalists were being sounded aloud. What reaction came from the left or the secular liberal political forces here? They were all silent. So things were happening in Bangladesh, and we have a social media where the people in West Bengal, we write in Bengali, and the people in Bangladesh, they write in Bengali, and we see each other's posts. The development in Bangladesh, come here, we all get to see what is happening in Bangladesh. During 2013-14, there was a rise of Islamic fundamentalism and radicalism in Bangladesh. Not only Hindus, every minority was targeted, even the atheists were targeted, bloggers were targeted. All these reports were coming here. And what reaction did the secular camp in West Bengal give to that incident, to those rise of radicalism in our neighboring land? There were also Hindus, they were facing attacks. So that was also human rights violation. But people in West Bengal were largely silent, and the right wing kept, they took over the issue. The right wing started highlighting the poor situation the minorities in Bangladesh were living in, and they used it to contrast the so-called Muslim appeasement or minority appeasement in West Bengal. And Mamata Banerjee was clearly trying to give an overt message by, wrapping her sari around her head in the style of a hijab. And so all these things created a ground for the Hindu right wing to champion their cause and to contrast how Muslims under Muslims in Hindu majority areas feel safe, but Hindus in Muslim majority areas feel unsafe. So they quite effectively contrasted the Bangladesh example with that of West Bengal.
Right. So basically, the alleged appeasement policies, undercover or blatantly, by both these governments, left government and the present dispensation, somehow led the way towards polarization in Bengal, what we are seeing now, right? I mean, the widening fault line that the chapter you have written, that chapter mainly deals with the polarization and how the fault lines we can now see, and it's very clear, the battle line is drawn. So it is basically that, and because of this kind of, you know, appeasement policies, because in urban center we still see people still talk about, you know, saffron is not our color, and we never preached, you know, Jai Shri Ram, we never chanted this kind of slogan. But then urban population forms really 20% of our electorate, and 80% is of course rural vote bank. Nobody really goes to that aspect and how that rural population, you know, had dealt and now dealing with the transformation. So basically the polarization is mostly being felt in the rural heartland of West Bengal, right? So now, you know, when you have, when you have like written, and if you can elaborate a little more on that polarization part, that how the issues which Bengal used to have, industrialization or, you know, farmers' policies, is it a class movement or it is going to be a movement for, you know, industrialization or everything. Now, there is no such discussion happening in Bengal. It's all about Hindu-Muslim. It's all about polarization. And that is precisely going to be the election issue.
Yes, see, the genie of identity politics is out of the bottle.
Right.
So now it's identity politics all over. It's BJP is saying that Mamata is running a 30% ki sarkar.
Right. And, it's basically religion-based politics.
Yes. And but TMC at the same time is trying to appease every community. She is trying to appease the Bengali sentiment. She is trying to appease the Hindi-speaking people. She is trying to separately address the Brahmin and the Dalits. And the women voters and the youth.
That so, is for us after 2019 election results.
Yes. Before that, Trinamool never had a community-specific approach.
Yes.
But it is because of this community-specific approach of the BJP and also of the RSS that they were managed to make inroads in the rural heartland. And see, the polarization is definitely stronger in the rural areas. Jai Shri Ram is much more popular in rural Bengal than in urban. And even if we look at BJP's organizational strength, it's a complete contrast to what it used to be 10 years ago. BJP in Bengal used to be known as an urban party with fringe existence in among people of areas dominated by Hindi-speaking people and even bordering areas.
Yeah, so it is still being called as a cowbelt party, a Hindi heartland party.
Yes. It actually is no longer a cowbelt party in Bengal, because in rural Bengal, BJP people have accepted BJP and they are shouting Jai Shri Ram. Yes, now, yes. At the same time, I have a feeling that the wave in favor of BJP in rural Bengal is less because of their identity politics or communal politics, and more because of genuine grievances against TMC's corruption.
Exactly.
So, people who were frustrated with TMC and felt suffocated, they in large numbers took to BJP, and once then they started mixing with the BJP people, joining their programs, and ideological influence there has been definitely, but the ideological influence is secondary. The primary reason was the anger against TMC.
Right. Basically, the votes BJP got in 2019, it's not exactly BJP's vote that it has got from its own support base. It is anti-TMC vote. They had to vote for some other party. They voted for BJP. And basically, the communal issues that it's often being discussed, debated, deliberated. But then, as you were mentioning, that it is also the corruption. It is also that cut money thing that angered angered the voters of, let's say, voters of Mamata Banerjee. So you have also you have a chapter, you have two chapters. One is on Battle for Bengal, and one is your the title of the book, that is Mission 2021. Your title of the book is Mission Bengal. So if you can elaborate how they are planning it, and what can be, I know you cannot, nobody can predict it. It's a very unpredictable election that we are approaching this time. But, you know, what are the telltale signs? How you see it?
You see, Madhupana, you have been covering Bengal for quite a long time, and you are saying that it is an unpredictable election. So everybody knows it's an unpredictable election. There are pros and cons for each and every side. And for BJP, there are the only the principal advantage of BJP is the blunders of TMC. Otherwise, okay. The party is in a lot of trouble here. They have their factional feuds. And I still think they are failing to prioritize between they have two primary agendas, if you see. One is to end Mamata's misrule, which includes this corruption and high-handedness. And the second is to turn Bengal in the real homeland for Bengali Hindus. So they have one developmental agenda and one communal agenda. Now, if you push through the communal agenda, you alienate the Muslims who are angry with TMC. And there are Muslims who are angry with TMC. There are a lot of Muslims in rural Bengal who say that Mamata has
failed them.
Yes, that Mamata has made more noise than real work on the ground.
They feel that they are used as vote bank.
Yes. So there is anger against Mamata Banerjee. But if the BJP continues to push through its communal agenda of turning West Bengal into a homeland of Bengali Hindus, as Shyama Prasad Mukherjee and V.C.S. did in 1947, then they will run the risk of alienating the Muslims, who make more than 1/4 of the state's population. And in that case, these Muslims, despite their disenchantment with the TMC, will be forced to vote for TMC just in the face of polarization. So the BJP is, it appears that they are yet to prioritize which is their primary agenda. It is to establish a homeland for Bengali Hindus or to end Mamata Banerjee's mission.
That means they have to choose between their communal agenda and the developmental agenda, as you mentioned.
Yes, they can't drop any. They will never drop any idea, but they have to set a priority.
Like rank.
Because pushing for one is hampering the interest of the other. So I don't see they have managed to balance it yet. And the second thing is that the so-called the lack of an acceptable face against Mamata Banerjee. But you see, there is no doubt that Dilip Ghosh is the most popular BJP leader in the state. No other BJP leader's popularity matches. But at the same time, it is considered by a section of BJP leaders and also political observers that Dilip Ghosh may not be, since he has made so many controversies with outrageous remarks, that he may not be accepted as a chief ministerial face by the educated and the cultured
Bengali Bhadrolok.
So I think that is why they have decided not to name any chief ministerial candidate and just to seek votes in the name of Modi. So they are depending a lot on Modi magic. Two things they are depending on. One, Modi magic. Two, the grievances against Mamata Banerjee. And they are yet to spell out very rightly how they will improve Bengal's economic and other, mostly the economic aspect. Because even Mamata Banerjee said during a press conference in July that during these two terms, she could not focus on employment generation. So her focus for her third term will be generation of employment. So what BJP will do to generate employment? They have not spelled it out clearly. There is anger against TMC over teachers' recruitment. There has been virtually no teachers' recruitment during the 9-year rule of TMC. But will BJP do it? The experiences of Tripura, which are coming to Bengal, of course, due to commonality of the language, we get to see that BJP government in Tripura are acting against the teachers' movements who are seeking permanent jobs. So will BJP complete this recruitment process? Have they promised it? So it's a lot unclear yet from the point of view of BJP's concrete strategy for Bengal. So the best bet for BJP is a failure of TMC. If TMC manages to somehow soothe the anguish of people, then they will have an advantage. But there, of course, are doubts whether it's too late. Because even Mamata's jihad against Katmani and Katmani Free Rao, and then she managed to recover image through this Katmani and DDK Bolo. But whatever gains she made, they are all lost now after this Cyclone Amphan scandal. So people are talking that Didi has no control over her party.
Yes. Basically, like you were rightly mentioning, BJP is riddled with factional feuds and everything. But then, similarly, Trinamool Congress, the ruling party, has more factions than any other political party can have in a state. Like in districts, if we ask that we want to go to TMC's party office, the locals, they ask, which goshti, that means which group you want to go. So yes, as you rightly said that people are actually talking about that Mamata Banerjee doesn't, she is losing control of her party. And like you have mentioned, this one chapter you have written on Bengal plan. So you have elaborated on BJP's plan or the Sangh Paribar's plan in Bengal, and you are saying that they are still pretty much undecided on what agenda they actually need to put forward and what agenda they need to just, you know, keep as a backup. Like you are saying that there has been no recruitment, there has been no job. We have been seeing so much of, you know, industry summits and everything and so big, very big announcements. But then you and I know nothing much actually happened, you know, on ground. So BJP doesn't really talk about that. They, two, three things they talk. That is one, they talk about corruption that is there. And this, primarily they talk about this Hindu-Muslim appeasement, etc., etc. So what is this really plan they are working on, BJP? Or they are yet to find any plan? It's just 6-8 months. We are just 6-8 months away from the election.
No, I think they are trying to find a convergence of these two streams of thoughts. They are yet to finalize a strategy, because it is kind of evident from the workings of two sets of leaders. If you look at Dilip Ghosh and Sayantan Ghosh, they are whatever they are saying will never attract a single vote from an intellectual person.
Yes.
Every single more word they say, as another intellectual will be alienated from the BJP. So they don't care for the intellectuals. At the same time, there are the likes of Mukul Roy, Swapan Dasgupta, and Babul Supriyo. And there is this Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Research Foundation in Delhi, the Delhi-based think tank. And of course, there are RSS leaders who are trying to address the intellectuals. The new editor of Swastika, he has been editing Swastika for the past 2 years, Shantidev Sengupta. They are trying to address the intellectuals. So at the same time, one section of the party is trying to address the intellectuals and trying to win them over. And at the same time, another section of the party is trying to ruin their project. So the confusion is quite evident. Now, whether it is entirely confusion or it is a planned ploy to let both happen, I can't tell it for sure. And it is too early to say whether this will pay or not.
Right. Only thing is BJP, as we see, BJP does have a very strong central command. It is as regimented as CPM. It is a regimented party. It's a cadre-based party, which of course Mamata Banerjee's party is not. And before 2019 election, we saw there was this, all these differences. There was this factional politics in BJP. But then when the election came and Amit Shah made some 2-3 visits, everything, you know, started falling in place somehow. So, but then Mamata's party is not like that. Mamata Banerjee says something.
It will happen the same once again. Modi and Shah start visiting Bengal 2-3 months ahead of the elections. So all these factionalism, they may be hampering the party right now. The party's growth right now, but the actual the tempo of the campaign, when it gets the momentum with Modi and Shah, and not only Modi and Shah, there will be Smriti Irani who will be speaking in Bengali, there will be Muktar Abbas Naqvi and other leaders.
Many leaders will come. Yes.
Yes. And all big guns will be coming here. So when these dozens of union ministers and chief ministers and Modi and Shah start bombarding Bengal with rallies, these factionalisms won't matter, I think.
Yes.
And this time, I doubt even for TMC if those factionalisms will work, especially because this will be a desperate survival bid for the TMC leaders also. So I think that when the polarization takes the sharpest, both camps will try to stick to their own votes, and of course there will be switching overs and there will be defection, and there will be defection from TMC left, Congress to BJP, and possibly also to TMC from some other parties. So it is very difficult to say how these equations will change, but once these changes have taken place, I think those in one vote will try to save their own vote, because it's a high-stake battle for both.
It is. For BJP, it is the last fort that is yet to fall to them. And for TMC, it is a battle for existence.
Yes.
For Mamata Banerjee, now or never kind of a situation. And you have also mentioned in your book that after 2019 election, how people saw Mamata Banerjee getting unnerved, the way she was speaking, then her decision to recruit a poll strategist, which that organization and the person, they are now literally supervising the party, controlling the party and its work, its actions, its movement, everything. That is also, you know, creating a lot of differences, of course, in districts, in blocks. So will that become a factor? And another thing I would just add, you were mentioning that there are chances, BJP wants, there are chances, and since BJP did not have a CM face as of now, so there are chances this fight is again going to be Modi versus Mamata in yes. Bengal, right? So, you know, do you really think that this Modi versus Mamata thing will work in an assembly election? Because state election does have very different issues than a general election generally has.
Yeah, that is true. But at the same time, people all over India are voting in the name of Modi. So this is some factor which we need to keep in mind. And what bigger bet than Modi does BJP have for Bengal? They don't have a face matching Mamata Banerjee's. Mm-hmm. And if we look at Uttar Pradesh, they named Jogi after they won.
In every state, in Assam, in Tripura?
Yes, in Assam, in Tripura, they named
the CM. They never had a CM face.
Yes. So they are going without a CM face. So just because they failed in Delhi, this model doesn't can this model cannot be said to be a failure. Yeah. And at the present juncture, I don't see BJP has a better bet than going with Modi's face.
Right. So anyway, we are all in for a very interesting and unpredictable, I suppose, historic and a very crucial election for Bengal. Thanks a ton, Snigdhendu, for joining us and for taking time. And also, I want to add, Snigdhendu has been a journalist. He still is a journalist. And apart from that, he is an author too. He worked with several national publications, including Hindustan Times. He writes Look, he writes for Where. So on that note, we are now closing this discussion. Thanks a lot. Thank you for joining, and best of luck for your book.
Thank you, Mona. Thank you very much.
Thank you.